Hey, welcome to Non-Standard Models, where we delve into the world of theoretical physics. Today, I'm here with Agostino Patella.
Hi, Giulia.
And Ilaria Costa.
Hi.
Agostino is a professor in Humboldt University, Berlin, and is working on theoretical particle physics using numerical simulations. And Ilaria is a PhD student working with Agostino. Thank you for being with us today.
Our pleasure.
Today, Agostino and Ilaria are going to tell us about computer simulations and how they can reveal important properties of the strong force and of particle physics in general. The strong force is one of the four fundamental forces of the standard model, and as the name suggests, is the strongest of all of them, even if it acts at short distances, as the size of a nuclei. The strong force is indeed responsible for the stability of every nuclei in every atom, and also for the existence of a very special class of particles, called hadrons. Agostino, what are these hadrons?
Hadrons are subatomic particles made of quarks and gluons. These quarks and gluons are elementary particles held together by the strong force. Hadrons might sound like exotic particles, but in fact are very common. In fact, two very known examples of hadrons are protons and neutrons that make up the nuclei of atoms. It might sound surprising, but there are still lots of properties of hadrons that we do not understand. That's because the theory that describes the properties of hadrons, which is called quantum chromodynamics, or QCD in short, is a very complicated one. For this reason, we cannot rely on blackboard calculations to calculate properties of hadrons, as we do, for instance, with electrons and photons.
And that's why instead we have to rely on computer simulations, right, Ilaria?
Right. As Agostino said, quantum chromodynamics is really a complex theory. But it turns out that if you consider these hadrons on a spacetime that is not continuous but discrete, so as a grid in a box, or as we call it, a lattice, you can use computers to obtain important physical properties of these particles. To make it clearer, we can think about that this discretization is similar to the resolution of a digital picture. The higher the resolution is, the sharper an image would be. But if we consider a picture with a smaller number of pixels, we will have less details on this picture, but we can still understand some features of it. We can imagine the lattice quantum chromodynamics is similar to this example. Again, as I said before, quantum chromodynamics is a complex theory, and we cannot simulate it perfectly on a computer. The reason why lattice techniques are so important is that they give us good approximations of our theory, good enough to give us physical predictions.
And that's ultimately what we want to do in theoretical particle physics. Then, let's dive into this topic. So how do we simulate QCD on the lattice? What kind of prediction can we make? Does this lattice framework really help us to better understand this theory? Let's find out. So, Agostino, you mentioned that we cannot study QCD with pen and paper. Is that because of the complexity of this theory?
Well, yes, but not only. If we look at the interactions of the standard model, they come with different intensity. For instance, the interaction that governs the physics of electrons and photons, the electromagnetic force, is particularly weak. And in this case, we can use pen and paper techniques to calculate properties of electrons and photons. On the other hand, the interaction that keeps together quarks and gluons, the strong force, is particularly strong, so we must resort to computer simulations to calculate the properties of hadrons. That's why lattice QCD is so important in the understanding of the strong force. The first physicist to notice this was Kenneth Wilson. He invented lattice QCD. He was coming from a statistical mechanics background, and he noticed that one could use the lattice discretization to model the strong force. However, at his times, in the mid-70s, computers were not powerful enough to be of any use for the study of the strong force yet.
Okay, so the lattice framework opened the door to the simulations of QCD. Ilaria, can you sketch how these simulations work?
Sure, but as I said before, running simulation on such a theory is a complex procedure. Let me try to explain it with a somewhat simpler example. Let's think about weather predictions. To get a weather forecast, the first thing you will do is to consider a three-dimensional grid. At each point of this grid, you will have some weather data. For example, we can think about the temperature, the pressure, the humidity, and so on. Then, each of these variables will evolve according to a certain mathematical equation. After we evolved these variables for a certain amount of time steps, we will be able to get a prediction of how the weather will be at a certain time we are interested in. Although there are some differences, lattice QCD behaves in a similar way.
Okay, so let's focus also on these differences. What are these differences?
Well, the most important difference is the fact that weather is a classical system, while the strong interaction is purely quantum mechanical. There is also another important difference. On lattice QCD, we have to consider the discretized time in the grid, so we have a space-time grid. Then this means basically that what we had in weather forecast algorithm, so the evolution in time, we don't have it in lattice QCD. And actually what the algorithm does is to generate a series of configurations according to the right probability.
Okay, I understand. So now that we have a rough idea of the theoretical framework behind lattice, I want to understand how does it work in practice. Agostino.
Yes, I can give you an idea of the steps that we need to do this in practice. So the first thing that we need to do is actually to decide what physical property we are interested in, what is the property of the hadrons that we want to study. And we need to develop the theoretical framework for it. Once we have this, we need to write down our own code. And this code is what we need to run our simulations. But these simulations are so long that we cannot run them on our laptop or our computer in our office. So for these simulations, we need to actually apply for computer time in large computing centers. The centers, they are publicly funded and they are dedicated to fundamental research. It's also very important that our code and our algorithms are very efficient because the simulations have a significant impact from the economical and environmental point of view. So once we have our theory, our code, and our computer time, we are ready to run our simulations. In practice, we need to choose some parameters. We need to run our simulations for a very long time. So we get our raw data, and then we need to analyze them, interpret them, in order to get actually the physical property observable that we're interested in.
Okay, this sounds like a long and strenuous process, but I can only imagine the excitement when you start to get an output out of your simulations. Ilaria, do you have some examples in mind of quantities that have been computed on a lattice?
Well, yes, there are many properties that have been computed in the past 40 years, from masses of hadrons to how they interact with each other and with other particles of the standard model. Let's go back to QCD and to our proton. If we were to sum the masses of the three quarks that form this particle, we will actually obtain a value that is only 3% of the total mass of the proton. That's because the remaining mass is given by the energy that is associated to the strong interaction of these three quarks, according to the formula E equals mc squared. In other words, 97% of our mass is given by the strong interaction. This process cannot be computed with pen and paper, but we can understand it with lattice simulations.
Mm-hmm. I see. But coming back to your great analogy of the pictures and the pixel scenario, while it's intuitive that by increasing the number of pixels, we get a sharper image, I'm wondering if the same is true for lattice QCD. I mean, how do we know that from the lattice predictions we get a reasonable result for the continuous spacetime?
Well, funny enough, we don't know. But what I mean by that is that we miss a rigorous proof. However, there is a strong numerical evidence that this happens. If we run simulations with a finer and finer grid each time, we can extrapolate the results in the continuum limit. Just like for weather forecasts, you can obtain accurate description of the weather, even if we are not considering all the smallest details of the atmosphere.
Okay, so to me it sounds like you're doing multiple experiments by running these multiple simulations. Is there an equivalent of the experimental uncertainties, Agostino?
Yes, Giulia, absolutely. So for instance, we need to consider that we have statistical errors. This happens because, as Ilaria explained before, the algorithms that we use are probabilistic. So if we're interested in a given physical observable, we actually get only a probabilistic estimate of it, and this comes with a statistical error. Now, what happens is that if we run our simulation for longer, the statistical errors become smaller and smaller and smaller. And this is the way in which we can keep it under control. But this is not the only source of error in our simulations. We also have, pretty much like in experiments, systematic errors that we need to take into account.
What are these systematic errors?
Well, there is many of them, but the two most common ones are related to the fact that we simulate with a finite lattice spacing and in a finite volume. Now, obviously, the universe that we want to reproduce is a continuous space. It has a continuous space-time, and it's infinite. So what we need to do is to repeat our simulations many times, reduce the lattice spacing, and increase the volume of our simulations and extrapolate to the physical setup. Every time we do an extrapolation, we have errors. These are called the systematic errors that we need to estimate correctly. And in fact, a big part of the job of us as researchers in lattice QCD is to estimate properly these errors.
And that's why we want to get high precision measurements, right, Ilaria?
Yes, and you might think that we want this to get results that are consistent with the experiments, but it's actually quite the opposite. We want to find discrepancies with the experiments and make sure that this is not caused by some random fluctuations. This is why we care so much about the errors.
I guess in these inconsistencies we are trying to find new physics, or?
Well, yes, because if we find results that are not consistent with our theories, this implies that we have to push further our models and try to understand where we should go with physics.
Agostino, how is lattice relevant for the search of new physics?
That's a very good question. So the interesting fact is that at the moment we do have some inconsistencies, or how we call them, tensions between experiment and theory. And in fact, most of the tensions in particle physics experiments involve hadrons, hadron physics, directly or indirectly. So it is really important to understand, in order to understand if these tensions are real or not, if they really indicate the existence of new physics or not, to calculate the property of hadrons to a very, very good level of accuracy. And this is where lattice QCD can help.
So we hope that new level of precision will push our theories further. But what are the main challenges at this point, Ilaria?
There are a lot of challenges that are coming in the future. For example, if we want to tackle a problem that is so far out of reach, we need to consider a wider range of energy scales in our lattice simulations. Also, it's important to consider that computer simulations need to run for a reasonable amount of time, like 5 years, for example.
Or really 5 years?
Yeah, it's not an exaggeration. In fact, for complicated projects, one might need to run simulations for a few years.
Yeah, and that's why it's important that improvements come not only from theoretical physics, but also from engineering and programming.
For sure, there are still many interesting research directions open. But Agustin, what is your perspective on the future of particle physics and lattice?
Well, Giulia, you know, the standard model is a very successful theory, and but we do know that it's incomplete. So there are phenomena that it's not able to explain. It doesn't incorporate gravity, it doesn't explain dark matter, dark energy. And so there is a lot of work that needs to be done here. If we talk about dark matter, for instance, we know very little about it. But if we have an hypothesis and a model of dark matter, we could ask ourselves, what is the effect of dark matter on hadronic physics? How dark matter would interact directly or indirectly with quarks? And this is something that we could investigate with lattice QCD, for instance. So we were talking before about tensions between experiments and theory, and one example that comes to mind is the so-called anomalous magnetic moment of the muon. So the muon is a heavier brother of the electron. But nevertheless, there is this particular property that we measure experimentally very, very precisely, which is somehow in tension with the theoretical prediction. And this is something that is very interesting to understand in the future. And in fact, the lattice QCD is really playing a very important role in trying to resolve this tension. Another thing that is already important and will become more important in the future is when we want to push the precision of our prediction to such high level, then one needs to take into account even the tiniest effects. So if you want to understand properties of hadrons very, very precisely, then we need to incorporate, for instance, effects and interactions of hadrons with photons. So what we call the electromagnetic effects on hadronic physics. And this is, for instance, something I'm working on at the moment.
Yeah, in the end, we put a lot of effort into trying to push forward our understanding of the strange laws that govern the behavior of these particles. Lattice field theory in the past has been fundamental in the development of the theory of the strong force, and it will continue to be at the forefront of theoretical particle physics in the future. We also hope that lattice field theory will give us some hints of new physics. Thank you, Agostino and Ilaria, for this shared space-time on the lattice.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. See you next time here on Non-Standard Models.